Let's go back to our worked example. Question: is the constant term B0 statistically significant, or is the estimate for B0 close to zero, or is it far enough from zero for us to conclude that the population intercept term is indeed non-zero? Let's look at the regression output again. Because we are talking about B0, which is the intercept term, we have to look at this row. And again, because we are testing for statistical significance, we can just look at the p-value. Why? Because by default, Excel has already conducted this test, whether the population B0 is equal to 0 or not. That is, Excel has already tested for statistical significance of the b coefficients. What do we mean by a statistically significant intercept term? Well, suppose we have the following population regression line. We can see here that the intercept term is non-zero. Therefore, the intercept term is said to be statistically significant, as its population value is different from zero. Now, suppose instead the population regression line looks like this. The intercept term, in this case, is equal to zero, so it's said to be not statistically significant or statistically insignificant in practice. We can't observe the population regression line, so we use the output from our sample regression line to judge whether the population betas are likely to be zero or not, that is, whether they are statistically significant or not. All right, so looking at the sample regression output, we simply have to look at the p-values, as Excel has already conducted the test for statistical significance. As you can see here, it's larger than 5%, so we do not reject the null hypothesis, and we conclude that the intercept term is statistically insignificant, which means the population regression is likely to have an intercept term equal to zero. Now, how could we conclude that the intercept term is statistically insignificant, which means its true population value is equal to zero, when the estimated sample intercept term is equal to 11,573.03? Clearly, it's not zero, right? Well, this is because 11,573 estimate occurred simply due to sampling variation or sampling error, based on the standard error. The calculations indicate that 11,573 is practically equal to zero, and there is not sufficient evidence for us to reject the null hypothesis of population intercept is zero. Next, we are going to use t-test to test statistical significance of B1. You have learned that easiest way is just to check p-value and compare the p-value with the alpha. We did that in the previous video. If the p-value is less than alpha, it is significant and reject the null. If the p-value is greater than alpha, do not reject null. Well, this time we'll go old school and answer this question by hypothesis testing and doing a t-test. That is, we state the null and alternative hypothesis, we write down everything we know from the question, then we draw the student t-distribution and critical value, then we calculate the t-value, and then we will make a decision either to reject or do not reject 80. This should look very familiar from hypothesis testing lectures from a statistical review in Chapter 2. If not, please be sure to review web resources in Chapter 2 now. With all regression-based hypothesis testing, we use the student's t-distribution as we are given the standard errors from the computer output, which have been calculated from the sample. That is, we are using sample standard deviations. First things first, we have to set out the null and alternative hypothesis. The question asks whether there is a relationship between advertising expenditures and sales, so it is asking us whether population coefficient beta 1 is equal to 0. Now, what does the counter claim? The exact opposite of this claim. Well, it must be that beta 1 is not equal to 0. Recall that the claim with the equal sign is a null hypothesis, so we can now write down the null hypothesis and the alternative hypothesis. That is the first step done. Time to write down all the information provided to us. Remember that the null hypothesis is assumed to be true until proven otherwise. Looking at the null hypothesis, we assume the population beta 1 is equal to 0 until proven otherwise. If we look at the Excel output, you'll see that the estimated sample beta 1 is equal to 4.97. So B1 is equal to 4.97. The standard error is also given to us in the sample regression output, and it is 1.23. So we write this down. Okay, what type of hypothesis test is this? Recall from the hypothesis testing. We can tell by looking at the sign of alternative hypothesis. Since it's not an equal sign, it must be a two-tailed test. This means the rejection region will be on the both sides of the distribution. Next step is to draw the student's t-distribution. It looks pretty much like a normal distribution. Recall that it's bell-shaped and symmetrical around zero. Since we figured out that it's a two-tailed test, then the rejection region must lie here in both positive and negative sides of the distribution. And we are taught to test at the 10% significance level, which means that the size of rejection region comprises 5% of the distribution, that is half of the alpha. So the next big step is figuring out the critical value, which is a cutoff point of the rejection region. When using the student's t-table to find a critical value, we'll have to know the degrees of freedom of the sample regression. It's simply equal to n minus k minus 1. N is the sample size, k is the number of regressors or x variables. So looking at the output, we can see that the sample size is equal to 7. The number of x variables is 1, as we are only analyzing the effect of advertising expenditures on sales and nothing else. So the degrees of freedom is 7 minus 1 minus 1, which is 5. This is a measure of how much information is contained in our sample. Let's look at our student t-table. We need to look for the row that corresponds to a degrees of freedom of 5. So this is a row we are working with. Now recall that the alternative hypothesis, since there is not an equality sign, this must be a two-tailed test. So we'll be looking at the significance level on this row. The question asks us to test at the 10% significance level, so we are looking at this column here. The critical value we need is this, the intersection of our degrees of freedom and the significance level. The critical value is equal to 2.015. However, since this is a two-tailed test with two rejection regions on the right-hand side, the critical value is going to be positive 2.015. On the left side of the distribution, the critical value will be negative 2.015. Recall that the student t-distribution is symmetrical around zero, so the critical value is below zero, must be a negative number. So our critical value is negative 2.015 on the left-hand side and positive 2.015 on the right-hand side. So back to our student's t-distribution, we know now the critical value, that is the cutoff of the rejection region. The next step is calculating the test statistics. Back to our Excel output now. It's tempting to use the t-statistics that is provided by Excel, as it is just staring right at us. However, I want you to see how we get this number in Excel. So we will calculate the t-statistics by hand. B1 is the sample estimate produced by the sample regression line, or it is produced by Excel. Beta1 is the hypothesized population beta, and the standard error of B1 is in the denominator. We are good to go subbing in values in the formula. We know that B1 is equal to 4.97. The null hypothesis, which is assumed true until proven otherwise, states that the population beta 1 is equal to 0, and the standard error from the Excel output is equal to 1.23. Let's sub these values. And when we sub the values, we see that the t-statistics is calculated as 4.03. So back to our output table, we found the same number as Excel does. Back to our t-distribution, we have calculated our t-stat, and as you can see, it's greater than the critical value, so it lies in the rejection region. This means we reject the null hypothesis. So we reject the null hypothesis at the 10% significance level, and we conclude that there is a statistically significant relation between sales and advertising expenditures. Next, I will talk about the new aspects of regressions, which is R-squared, or coefficient of determination. Here is the question. What percentage of variation in sales does variation in advertising expenditures explain? In other words, how good is advertising expenditures at explaining sales? Well, simply look at the Excel output for the sample regress and we'll find R-square statistics here. Convert that to a percentage and we will get 76.53%. This tells us that variation in advertising expenditures explains 76.53% of variation in sales. Alternatively, we can view this as a regression model explaining 76.53% of variation in sales. The R-square can be interpreted as a measure of how good the regression model is. Does it explain a lot about the Y variable, or does it explain very little about what is going on in the Y variable? If the regression model explains 76.53% of variation in sales, then the natural question to ask is, what happens to the other 23.47% of variation in sales? Well, 23.47% of variation is explained by other factors that are not included in the model. See, we have our sample regression model, but there are other factors that explain sales that are not contained in the model, but these are contained in the residual term. So the R-square statistics tells us that 76.53% of variation in sales is explained by advertising expenditures. Let's go through a brief summary of each concept. First, population regressions and sample regressions. The population regression is a true relationship between X and Y, but we cannot observe this. The sample regression is a regression line that we do observe, and that's what we use to make inferences about the true relationship between X and Y. Second, we have talked about dependent and independent variables. The dependent variable is affected by the independent variable. For example, sales was a dependent variable. The independent variable, such as advertising expenditures in our example, is not affected by the dependent variable, so the causality runs one way. Third, statistical significance. That is the coefficient likely to be non-zero in the population regression. If it's statistically significant in the sample regression, then the answer is yes. If it's statistically insignificant in the sample regression, then the answer is no. The test for statistical significance is conducted by default in all statistical software packages such as Excel, SPSS, eViews, SAS, etc. Fourth, how do we make inferences about the true population regression using only the estimated sample regression line? Hypothesis testing. We follow the same steps as usual. State the null and alternative, draw the t-distribution and rejection regions, etc., etc. Make sure you always use the t-distribution for sample regressions. We never use the z-distribution. Next, regression residuals. These are the factors that affect y beyond x. Formerly, it's a difference between the actual value of y and the predicted value of y using the sample regression line. In our sales and advertising expenditure example, residuals will include factors such as customer service, travel packages, etc. We also covered the error term. Again, it's also the other factors that affect y beyond x. However, now it's the difference between the actual value of y and the predicted value of y using the population regression line, not the sample regression line. The residuals are sample estimates of the error terms. How to make predictions about y? It's very straightforward. Once we have written down the sample regression equation, given the value of x, we simply substitute its value into the sample regression line to make a prediction of y. Remember, this is only a prediction and is likely to contain an error. We also talk about this standard error. Standard error measures the variation in sample coefficient estimate. If you were to resample from the population repeatedly, it can also be interpreted as a measure of how reliable the sample coefficient estimates are. Finally, R-square statistics. This reports a proportion of variation in Y that is explained by the model. It's a measure of how good the model is. You finished the lecture on simple regression, and thanks for hanging in there till to the end.